Hello. It's great to see you. Thank you so much for your time today. And we're so happy to have you showing up every Thursday on this call. So my name is Lizelle. I'm the customer service and sales manager here at Highland Park Lapidary. I wanted to officially welcome you to our 26th live interactive webinar. So I wanted to say hello and welcome as well to all our customers and followers that are streaming with us live, both on our Facebook and YouTube channel. Thank you so much. All right, guys. So we created this avenue for the opportunity to network and to collaborate. So let's go and be interactive tonight. Let's start by saying hello to our fellow artists. So on the bottom part of your Zoom, you can see there the chat box. Okay, so if you are new, please put new on the chat so we can welcome you. Or if you have been here and your friends are here, you can say hi to them as well. And for the team, this is our chance as well to meet and greet those who we spoke to on the phone. So there you go. Keep it coming. Let's go. Hi, Gary. All right. Okay, wow. Let's go ahead and welcome them, guys. Hi, Fred. All right. Wow. Okay. Hi, Steve. Let's go. Okay. Wow. Thank you so much, guys. Yep. So again, this is the place where we share our knowledge, ask our questions, and get tips and tricks all about the lapidary art. And tonight will be another fun and interactive session. So our topic tonight is transforming rocks into stunning and unique pieces of art. And we are so honored to have our guest speaker tonight, no other than Donald Laufer, owner of Headswater Lapidary. Let's give him some love as well on the chat. Thank you so much for having you, Don. And for Q&A as well, you can raise your hand if you have any questions by going into our reaction icon at the bottom part of your Zoom and click raise hand, or you can also post your questions on the chat. I so love our chat is coming along. Thank you, guys. So everybody's excited. So let's join our CEO, Jen Rowland, and our general manager, Sherman Rowland, together with Don, to kick off our 26th live interactive webinar with our intro video.
Great to have you here tonight, and really welcome back to all of you who, many of you that I know, talk to you on the phone all the time. I know I talk to Fred and a bunch of the other folks that I see on this call. So it's great to have you here, and I'm really stoked to have you here, Don. Tonight, you're going to see something super cool. Don is, we'll have you talk a little bit about your background here in just a second, but Don is going to show you some techniques that are entirely new to me. And really, you're going to see some of the ways in which he's innovated how to really cut rock and be able to produce bowls and vases and other shapes that you typically don't think would be readily able to be done. And so you're going to really like what he's going to show you tonight. And I also have to say, like, one of the things I was so impressed with, Don, when you and I talked, your studio is ridiculous. Like, it is the ultimate friggin' dream study studio. And it's right there south of Pittsburgh. I mean, it's like, who would guess? Everyone thinks Lapidary is on the West Coast, and like, boom, you've got this awesome, awesome facility. We're going to give you guys a tour of his facility. He shot a video, so we're going to do a tour. John, great seeing you this morning. You have not got your Starbucks yet, I can tell.
Nope, not yet.
Starbucks. I'm like a little jacked. So anyway, So Don, talk to us a little bit about your background and like just to share so people know, because your history in gemstone cutting goes back a number of years and you've seen the industry really evolve.
Yeah. Well, I probably started collecting rocks when I was 10. You know, went to the museum and the gift shop had those sample cases of rocks and minerals, and picked up this book here. And there's a couple of pages on lapidary. And I thought, I would like to do that. And there was a gentleman, Robert McDonald, everyone knew him as Pastor Bob, who did this. And I asked him if he would teach me. And I was 12 years old at the time, and that was 1966. Mm-hmm. And since then, I've been mostly teaching myself from making mistakes and learning from those. When I turned 16, we lived near Philadelphia. And there was a rock shop just about 4 miles north of us, and that was Lapidary. If any of the old timers might know them. And I started working there and made a few extra bucks and bought some more tools and machines and kept going. I guess around 1974, 76, the Lapidary hobby was going downhill. And I went off to New York for a short while they were building this factory to cut diamonds in Bridgeport, Connecticut. Mm-hmm. I lasted a year there and then decided I was going to go to GIA and got my graduate gemologist title from there. And that was 1980. Came back to Pittsburgh where we were living before and started working with Penn Gem International. At that time, it was Pennsylvania Gem Company. And from then, that was around 1980, that I was doing trade work for them. So jewelers would be sending stones that needed to be repaired, repolished. They would send pieces of jewelry that were missing an odd-shaped stone, an odd-sized. They wanted one to match, so we would do that. I would do that. I would cut all the stones to fit or do the repair work. And I did that there for over 40 years. And I've pretty much retired now. I started the school here in this house about 16 years ago. It was part-time then, mostly in the evenings and also Saturday mornings. And then when I did retire a few years ago, I put in a lot more daylight hours. So we have 3 days a week from 10 till 4 during the day to come. And you don't have to spend the whole 6 hours. You can just come for 2 or 3, whatever you want. And it's worked out very well. It's been a lot of fun.
So I think retirement for you, though, is like a metaphor. Because when I look at what you're doing, I'm like, kicking butt. It's not like, oh, I'm retired. It's like, I'm still
working.
Yeah.
I still do a little bit of trade work, but not as much as before.
Yeah. Now, did a lot of your work was faceting or like the whole realm of lapidary?
It was faceting mostly, some diamond cutting and some cabochons. You know, you had a lot of rings, gents rings especially, that were missing a black onyx.
Yeah.
And I would cut one to fit that ring.
I gotcha. Yeah.
Or maybe you had a lady's pin that was missing a 2 millimeter square sapphire. Yeah. I would do that. replace that one. And a lot of them weren't just 2 millimeters square, you know, they were tapered baguettes, or they had all different settings. And so you had to cut them to fit.
Right. So you really learned then how to reverse engineer shapes and being able to then, you know, say, yes, okay, I got to match this. So a lot of building a real knowledge around that and then how to do that cutting. It's funny, we started in Lapidary. John and I started, John was 10 and I was 5. So kind of similar path. We were in the Dayton, Yellow Springs area, and our parents bought us a Highland Park 10-inch trim saw, which you have one. That 10-inch trim saw, and then as crappy rock raster, right? The little, like rattling sheet metal thing we had, a little rock raster, right? That rock rascal.
Yeah, it was like a rock rascal grinder.
Yeah, it was like this was like 1970, so like quality was not the top job. It was like, oh, here it is. It's kind of crappy, but that's how we got started. So it's kind of similar. Like I was 5. I was very frustrated because we didn't have power feed. So I remember hanging on the gravity cord of that thing, trying to get it to go faster. So, well, you know, why don't we show people a tour of your studio? Let's start with that. And then we'll really get into that, because when you see Dawn's studio, is kind of over the top. It's cool. So Joanna, why don't you roll that first video? And then, wait a second, Louise is having problems getting audio. So one of the things you want to do, Louise, well, she can't hear me. So some of my team, Car, private chat her helper, help some of the people just in the chat on getting their audio going. And then we'll go ahead and roll that first video. Joanna. This is retirement.
Yeah. So here's a short video of my studio. This is a diamond sawing bench. I have one saw on it and numerous tangs for faceting. Some of my work. Over here we have the diamond bruting machine and a couple of tangs. It's for shaping the diamonds round. Can actually do ovals and pears and marquees. This is the skive bench. There's a few tangs in the background there. That's actually for cutting the facets on the diamond. Over here, this section is for faceting. I have several of different makes and models. This is the OMF machine. There's an Ultratech, a Graves, a Facetron. This is my jam peg machine. It is hand operated. Just kind of a novelty, but actually it's a lot of fun to use. And I like it a lot. This is our dopping bench, another faceting machine, another one. Some of the students keep their faceting machines here, and the rest are mine. There's a polymetrics, a Raytec, an old Graves. Another facetron. Here for cabs, we have our table of slabs and templates and a dopping station. Here we have a 6-inch trim saw, an old Highland Park, and a 10-inch Highland Park slab trim saw. Here we have a small diameter grinding wheels on there, a 6-inch combination unit, and another 6-inch combination unit. Over this way, we have a diamond carving machine here. It's actually a glass engraver, but I use it for carving. All sorts of grinding wheels and accessories. I do not teach the jewelry arts, but they're for anyone who wants to use it. There's a bench, polishing wheel. We also have vacuum casting equipment. Like I say, I don't teach it, but it's here for anyone who wants to use it. Here we have the 12-inch agate slab saw, an ultrasonic drill, a rotary drill. This is our vertical disc grinder. You can do a lot of intarsia or just shape your cabochons before you grind the dome. This is our lathe for polishing cups and bowls. And there's a polishing unit. This is a vertical with a felt wheel and a leather disc on that one. This is one of our sanding units here, 8-inch by 3-inch drums. Here's a polyarbor with 8 by 1.5 inch diamond grinding wheels. Another one, still one more, and another 8-inch by 3-inch sanding drum unit here. And here we have a horizontal polishing wheel with some accessories. And this one here is our flat lap. Made this in high school back around 1971. Still works great today. And here we have our 8-inch Highland Park combination unit. And that's pretty much it. My water line is all hooked up to the main water line in the house. So all we have to do is turn the valves. The only problem is the water drains into buckets, and on a busy day, I have a lot to clean out. So that's it. Thank you.
That's a ridiculous. So that's retirement. It looks
that's
like
retirement.
You got a lot of stuff going there like that.
So basically, how many people want to retire like that?
I don't know.
Put it in the chat. Do you want to retire like that?
Yeah. and the bigger saws are outside.
Yeah, I know you got some.
Yeah, that is
awesome. Bigger iron there. Yeah, no, that's awesome. Now, how many students typically are in, you know, coming through and learning?
Usually during the day, about 7.
Mm-hmm.
Saturdays right now are the busiest. In that video, the first part of the video, there were 14, which really kept me busy that day.
Yeah. Yep. Well, I mean, you know, one of the things that really, like, I love about what you're doing, Don, is you are really, like, you're taking your knowledge and all that you've invested, and you're really sharing that back. And that's, you know, for us to do the webinar together, because you all are going to learn so much from what Don has done, because he's got this really long legacy of working in the industry and seeing the industry change. I mean, you and I talked about when industry, like Providence, Rhode Island, used to be hotbed of a lot of jewelry manufacturing here. And, you know, it's changed. There's still chain being made here, but a lot of the you know, like you talked about in Bridgeport, the diamond cutting operation, you know, there you can see kind of the changes in that. And of course, what we see right now is a lot of people post and during COVID, a lot of cutting coming back, but it's more like the person who has a shop and they're working on a high end. They're like, there's a guy that I was speaking to today, high end types of work that he's doing, that, you know, provides good margin for him, and he can really do the work that he wants, you know. So that's certainly, we're seeing a reshoring of cutting, certainly in the States. I mean, that's reflected in our growth for sure. And more serious production cutters, like you've seen on some of the other webinars. So how long have you faceted? Like, what, if you think about faceting, is like 40, 50 years of faceting?
Let's see. I faceted my first stone would have been 1970. I had an MDR faceting machine.
Yeah.
So 1970, I started. Yeah.
That's awesome. Well, that's awesome. Glenn was saying he's been your student for 14 years. He's excellent with his faceting knowledge. And that's what I always do at Don's with my own facetron. Yeah. Awesome. Awesome, Glenn. Yeah.
Definitely.
I love what David said. What's that?
One of my prize students.
All right.
Well, they're all my prize students.
David said, retirement is a word for doing what you really want to do. I think John and I kind of retired then, aren't we, dude? we're doing it for work, but
I guess I would say I retired in 2004, because that's when I started really working on this.
Yeah.
Way more fun than working in semiconductors. Semiconductors, a pressure cooker.
Yeah. Well, let's go to the next video, and then we're getting questions here, which we'll come into on the question. But let's jump into the first video. And then we'll start answering questions as we go along. So put your questions in the chat. I will make sure, because those come up on this screen. My team is capturing that, and we'll make sure that we cover every single question you have. So don't worry, just put it in the chat. The team will get it and we'll answer it. All right, so Joanna, let's roll that next video.
Well, the first step I take when trying to decide what kind of a bowl or whatever to make is to pick a piece that I think is going to make one that's got a nice pattern, shape, and looking to see if there's any obvious cracks or other defects in there that's going to prevent me from making a nice one. So, this one's got an interesting red spot in the middle, but would that grind out? I'm not sure. Nice piece with some white, but not too dark around the edge. Interesting, not really sure what's in this one. Nice pattern. Same with that one. Not really sure what this one would look like. And this one here, yeah, that one looks pretty nice. And this one also. But until we cut them open, we're just not gonna know for sure what's in there. So the next thing I'm going to do is get ready to mark them. So I've got two of them here I'm just going to mark. Some of the others I'm not going to at this time, just because they don't need it. And this will give me an idea of where to start sawing. I'm just using whatever I have that's round that'll kind of fit the piece of the rough. And I will saw on the outside of those lines. Considerably smaller, probably. So, because it goes all the way up here, too. So, no, this one's not going to make it. Okay, so the first one had a pretty nasty crack in it and couldn't use it, so we're going to try this one. In there nice and tight. Adjust this and saw blade so it cuts where I want it to. Not so sure. That could be a crack. Yeah, it probably is. Might end up nice, but much smaller. Well, they say the third time's the charm, so we'll see. Nice. I don't see any cracks. Might make a nice bowl or cup. Okay, I decided I would take the second one we did and make it a little bit smaller so that when I design the outside and cut the inside, that little crack there will be gone. So I'm going to trim off the excess now with this saw.
So you're using my favorite kind of drop saw. That's a little a little Lortone drop saw, 14 inch.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. That saw, we, you know, when we made that saw again, we put those counterweights on it. Oh my God, it's ridiculously fast cutting. And I'm obviously, we sped the video up, but for folks who haven't used a drop saw is insane. And you, I saw you were like, I don't want to work that sucker, because you can really push through the stone. Now when you're looking at the stone, I like, obviously you're looking for fractures. Talk to people about like, what's the concern? What are you trying to pay attention? Cause some of the people that are new, this is like really good what you're paying attention to here when you're working a piece.
Okay. I'm looking for defects in the stone. Cracks are the main thing, and it's very difficult to find a large piece without a crack. So I go through several before I do. The other problem I would have is that you get a crystalline pocket, and they grind so much faster than the agate does that it really starts grinding off center. And if it goes all the way to the edge, you might as well scrap it. You just can't do it. Yeah, that's what I'm looking for. A nice pattern, of course. Now, a light brown one is not such a bad idea, because you can put it in the kiln for several hours, slowly bring it up to 500 degrees, and then turn it off and let it cool down, and it will turn a nice orangey red color. So just because it doesn't have a lot of dark brown in it, doesn't mean it's not going to look nice once you heat it up.
Right. And then when you're doing that process, are you also doing that in sand, or what's your process for when you do that?
I just set it in the burnout oven. And let it go up to 500 degrees slowly, and depending on the size, how many hours, I'll leave it sit there, and then just shut it off and let it cool down on its own.
Gotcha. Yeah.
So it's not embedded in sand or anything.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah, I know, so John.
You do the heat treat before you cut the stone into
final shape? Actually, I finish the whole thing and take a chance.
Okay.
All those hours into it, and then, but I haven't had one crack yet either, so we're good.
Yeah.
Well, it's actually possible that you're getting an advantage because you've reduced the material a lot, so the expansion is less likely to impact you.
Yeah.
And the inconsistent one thing's cooler, faster. It's like boom. It was like when we work with optical spheres, optical quartz, like those are tricky because, you know, who was it? Somebody was working.
If you get a beginner on the polish and they get it in the polish machine and let it get really hot, what happens is the outside of the sphere is expanding and the inside isn't. So you get this spiral crack around the outside of the ball.
Right. Well, I've done that several times.
Yeah.
So let's take some of these questions. Gary was asking, was it 500 degrees F, which it's 500 to 550 degrees F for things like Brazilian agate.
Yeah, I've done some of the Ohio flint to that temperature. If you start getting hotter than that, then you've got a chance of it cracking.
Right.
So just keep the temperature down low and leave it in longer.
Yeah,
for any of your agates that you're working on, cabs or anything.
Yeah. So Ron had some questions. I'm going to start going through. So Ron Gall had a question. He saw that vertical lap, and that vertical lap with the two discs, that's actually a dental lap, right?
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
And I took the silicon carbide plates out and bought some diamond coated plates and replaced it with that.
Yeah.
You know, that's an interesting design.
Yeah, I had the coarse on one side and the medium grid on the other. So we'll rough it out to shape and then go to the other side and do it.
Yeah, no, it's pretty cool. I've seen somebody else who's using one of those dental machines as well for, I think they're using them for doing dental fixturing or whatever, and you repurposed it, which is awesome. And Gary was asking about that too. He's like, what brand is the vertical disc machine? Which I think, Gary, you're referring to the same thing.
Yeah.
The white one.
Shucks, I forget the name of the brand offhand, but I'm sure you could find it if you Googled dental grinder or dental disc grinder. I think there's only one company that makes a dual one like that.
Right.
This one I picked up off of eBay. They said it powered on. So it did, but then of course it started to smoke pretty bad. So I opened up the electrical compartment, replaced all the wiring and switches, and it works great.
Yeah. Yeah. No, that's cool. That's cool. John's like, tell us more about the lathe. That's coming. John, we're going to cover more. That is coming. Michelle said, is there any Highland Park faceting machine? Well, damn, that's a great question. Certainly it's our intention to do that. And we were just talking to Dawn about that. Because faceting, we love faceting. I'm not a faceter. I'm aiming to learn faceting. And of course, I need to go to school to learn that. It's either going to be Pennsylvania or it's going to be
always Georgia. Welcome here.
I know. Well, it's on my way home. So I can come by your place and I'm going to hang out at Dawn's place. So right down, go Route 70 straight across. Isn't it 70 or 80? It's 70.
70.
70. 70. Yep. Yep. I go down 81 to what, 80 to 70 or whatever. So Leslie was asking about your school and classes. Can we just throw up so people can copy it? Cause I know people may be asking the question. Do you guys throw up the QR code thing and put in the link to Dawn, you know, how Dawn would people get a hold of Dawn to connect with him? Cause there's a bunch of people on the eastern part. So there's Instagram, Headwaters Lapidary. There's the website up in the chat. And you guys have one of those like, here's the QR code. So if you just take a photo of that little QR code, and then you can also then look that up too. Dawn does amazing stuff. Like we're going to get into, if you look at that fancy Jasper Sugar Bowl, you're going to see the technique on how he approaches that. And so I think tonight's going to be really cool. But take a picture of that or screenshot this, and we'll come back to this as well. Let's see. Connie says, hey, the drop saw looks like a thinner blade. What blade are you using on your 14-inch drop saw?
I don't know the thickness of it offhand. I would imagine around 50 thousandths.
Okay. Well, that's about the same thickness as the green line that we ship. That's a fairly... Yeah. Yep.
They're noisy. They're messy, but they are so quick and versatile. When that one wears out, I'm getting one of yours.
Yeah. We beefed it up a lot, you know, but it's the same basic concept. We thought that was a brilliant saw and they stopped making it. And I'm like, the only thing is like ours, when you tilt the head back, it won't flip backwards. It's heavy. The whole tank is a lot heavier. I think it's like 40 or 50 pounds heavier because we wanted it really rugged. And so you could throw that back with weight.
Because I had one of the old ones, and if you didn't have it bolted down, you flip the head back, it'd go over backwards on the bench.
Yeah, just got to hold on to it.
And we put a NEMA 56 motor on it.
And there's a little clamp I got. Yeah. And there's a little clamp I got. You clamp it into the vise, and it's spring-loaded fork, and you put your geode in there.
Oh, yeah.
You can just do them one right after the other. It has been a great show that I used to go to. And we would sell them one right after the other for 4, 5, 6 hours straight.
Yeah.
It's great.
Those big ass wing nuts that you have on there, where'd you get those?
I think the hardware store.
I want some of those, Sajan. That's a good enhancement. Like, cause you can wing those suckers.
Big ass wing nuts.
It's a lot better than taking a wrench to the nuts.
Well, I have the little ones, but I like that being a zing, 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 zing. Cause I want to go fast. You know, put that thing up and down fast. So I saw that. I'm like, I'm going to find those. Okay. Connie says, we answered that. Lori says, can't you use a core drill? Lori, I don't know what the context of your question was on this.
Oh, for preforming for a bowl.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think that would take a lot longer and probably a little more expensive because you'd be wearing out those core drills to do it. I have heard of some people boring out the center first by using a series of different diameter core drills mm-hmm. and then chipping it out. I haven't done that yet.
Right. I mean, Lori's got a core drill. I mean, Lori, just stick a socket down in there. I think it'd actually be real fast. I mean, we can drill that size round in.
Yeah, I can drill through. If you had like a 4-inch Brazilian nodule, I could drill the whole exterior of it in 3-4 minutes.
Well, then that's something I better consider.
Yeah, dude. I mean,
yeah, what the key is, Don, is the matrix, the diamond matrix in the core drill. If you grab any commercial core drills that are out there that are sold presently, they're all for asphalt and concrete, and they just don't like hard stone. So you got to have hard stone matrix in there, and then it just eats it up.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I'll look into that then.
Sandy was asking, how many saw blades do you go through per piece per week? I assume Sandy on the drop saw, you're asking the question when he was drop saw. I think it's like, you probably, they're lasting you years, right? Your blades?
They're lasting years, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, they're not running 24/7.
Yeah.
But yeah, I've got those blades on there for years.
Yeah. 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 I mean, even in our factory, when we were cutting between 1 and 2 ton of rock a week, I mean, how long would blades last in the Philippine factory?
On the drop saws, I think we'd run them nonstop for like literally we were cutting 10 hours a day, 5 days a week, and then 8 on Saturdays. And we might wear out a blade in 5 months.
Right. Blades,
I mean, huge amount of rock. Like a guy's just standing there just one after another.
That's all they do. Yeah. Yeah. Connie's asking, what's my 10X refer to? Come to the marketing webinar and I'll talk about that. That'd be fun. So we'll be doing some stuff on marketing. We'll talk about that. JP says, does heat treating on the agate actually increase the brittleness of the stone?
Yes, it does. That might be a good reason why I heat treat them last instead of before I get started.
Oh, yeah. Yep. Yep.
Yeah, this is why the nappers heat treat is because then the stone can fracture fluidly, so they get the really smooth chips across the surface of the arrowhead point. But it does affect the nature of the stone so that it can be chipped more easily.
Yeah. Yeah, I think Chris Strickland, he does heat treating on his stuff too. I think he talked about that in his webinar. Tad was saying, what's the purpose of heat treating and will it work with fluorite? You want to talk about that a little bit, Don? Or I John?
I don't know about fluorite. I mean, fluorite's heat sensitive, shock sensitive to begin with. It just takes a light colored agate and makes it a nice orangey red color.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it does.
Yeah. Well, if you also look at the cathedrals, like if you go to Tucson or anything, and you'll see the ones that are heat treated, you know, they're going to look different when they heat those. So you've got more of the yellow versus the purple in terms of.
So as long as the amethyst has iron in it and you heat it, it will turn into a yellow citrine. If there's no iron in it, it won't change color.
Right. Yeah. Is HP going to make a vertical lap? Yeah, absolutely, Ron. It's actually going into production next week or this week. Are you in production this week?
I'm working on it right now. I got the design basically done. I got to put water drips on it.
Right. And we've been actually talking, I know we mentioned Allison Sona, who's really the guy behind that and was involved also with really the establishment of the William Holland School Lapidary. And he's getting a kick, and like, because I mean, we want to really support his legacy, because, you know, he's 95, I think he's 96 this week, And that for us, it's like the guys really did something that really helped open up an entire hobby. We want to build on that and really make that more available to more people. And so he's kind of liking that, like, because it's like, you know, he's an older dude, and he's like, he did the pancake flipper. He did a lot of stuff. I mean, really an interesting guy. He actually worked in Hopedale right by my house. So we have a lot of nice connection. I got to go visit him. Nikki said, what's the difference in grinding a facet on a diamond versus a softer stone, corundum agate? Can I use the same faceting machine?
No, you can't. the diamonds are not going to stand. You're going to get a lot of chipping and abrasion. You'd need a microscope to see it probably, but faceting machines do not spin true enough. There's a little too much vibration. And the iron wheels that we're using to cut the diamonds, they are about 12 to 14 inches in diameter. They're an inch thick when they're new. They spin at 2600 RPM. They have to be extremely balanced and very smooth, so you don't get these little chips, microscopic chips, left on your facet junctions. And also, diamonds are cut dry, so they do generate a little bit of heat, but your diamond also, you're cutting with diamond. But there's a direction in the diamond crystals that are soft and directions that are hard. So if you know the diamond crystal to begin with, you can always turn that tang so that the wheel's going across the diamond in a soft direction, and it will cut down. Not very quick, but it will cut down. And the diamond is probably a little too fine on the diamond cutting wheel to cut sapphire. And again, there's no water dripping on it.
So in the chat, put in the chat, yes, if you would love to learn about faceting from Don. I'm trying to get him to do faceting. Who put in the yes? Come on, put some yeses down there. I'm gonna put yes. There we go. Do we need to ask?
We need to ask.
Yes. I mean, because Don's done this, like it's rare to get somebody like Don where you're going to see what he has to do here, but he has this wealth of knowledge. That's why I'm so stoked that we're doing this thing together. It'll be fun. Yep. Everybody, it's pretty universal. Do they think they want to learn something from you? It's good. So let's roll another video. Okay. Roll the video there, Joanna.
Okay, now what I'm going to do is round off these corners a little bit on the grinding wheel, give me a little better idea of what I can get out of this. That's enough. The lathe will take off the rest. Okay, now this step is where I glue the dot stick to the bottom of the stone. This is aluminum rod that I drill and tap, and I'm just going to epoxy on here. Now just watch it for a few minutes and hope it doesn't move. Otherwise, push it back to where it should be. That looks pretty good. All right. Looking at the piece and getting it mapped out, I think I can be 2.5 inches in diameter at the top and 1.5 inches in diameter on the bottom, and it'll only be about 1 inch thick. So I'm going to mark out those dimensions a little bit on the graph paper. I want about 3 inches, all a little extra for what I need. That'll put me here. And 1.5 inches. And there's 1/2. And 1 inch. that's my template. The next step will be to put everything on the lathe and show you how that process goes. And just kind of give you an idea of what that bowl is going to look like around the outside.
Why don't you roll the next video as well?
So this is the sculpture rock lathe I purchased from Diamond Pacific a few years ago. I replaced one part with one that I made. This allows me now to thread the dop stick, as I call it, onto the machine here. So I'm going to start setting things up and then we'll get going. It is very noisy and there's a lot of water splash. So I'll also wear some hearing protection. So the next step in this bowl making process is to smooth out the outside and finish grinding it to the shape I want, and also to bore out the center. Get a little water on here, so it's dripping. I'm also using a Fordham quarter horsepower DC drive motor with their square drive flex shaft. On here I've got I think this is about a 40 grit, which is really a little too coarse for the agates. They chatter and it's going to take a little longer to get the marks out. But I'll turn it on here. Looks like I got it. Shape's pretty nice. The next step will be to bore out the center.
So you covered a bunch of different things there. So on the template, you want to talk a little bit about that template, because I don't think people fully saw how that tracks, how the lathe tracks on that.
Okay. It's kind of like a key making machine. So you measure the stone that you have and decide how thick it's going to be and the diameter that you can get out of that, mm-hmm. the top diameter, the bottom diameter, and then take a piece of graph paper and start mapping that out. So in this case, it was only going to be an inch thick. So I'm covering 1 inch on the graph paper and I'm leaving myself a little extra in the front and in the back, the two sides, so that I can set that guide on that. And it also, if I'm not there to stop it and it goes past the end, it's not going to come crashing down and damage my machine. Uh-huh. And you only need to do a template half as thick as half the diameter on your template. So you don't have to worry about that. And yeah, you're just kind of looking at the stone, making some measurements. Okay, I can get it this thick. I'm going to have to make it a little smaller here because there's a dimple in the piece of rough, or that's where I'm going to put a special shape onto the stone. Yeah. And then you put it onto that machine. Now it's very slow, and the guide, it's a little roller bearing and it's on a thread. And that's slowly turning around. So it travels about 1 inch every 3.5 minutes. And that blade follows that, and it goes up and down depending on the template onto your rock. Now, so you're only going to be able to take off maybe 1/8 of an inch at a time on a hard agate.
Right.
So you're into many passes.
The multiple passes.
And if you're doing a large stone, you better have something else to do while you're standing out there pulling weeds, washing the cars, and things like that. Yeah.
Well, I like that you created that whole dop, you know, holding the piece on a dop.
Right.
What kind of epoxy did you use to hold that?
That's 5-minute epoxy.
Just a standard 2-part.
Yeah, standard 2-part, 5-minute epoxy. I definitely give it at least 12 hours before I will use it.
Yep.
Dop wax is a little tough because you got to get the stone nice and warm. Also, it's a little too brittle. You'll pop the stone off.
Right.
So the epoxy works very well.
That's great.
And then it off in the end, you have to heat it up. You have to warm up the stone a little bit, but mostly you're heating the dop stick up until the epoxy is soft enough you can pull it off, which you'll see, I think, in another video.
Yeah. Why don't we run that next video there, Joanna?
Okay, set this up to bore out the center, so we'll get a little water on there, and away we go. Okay, now I got the inside board out the way I like it. Maybe 3/16 of an inch thick or so. I'm going to work on sanding the outside at first and switching the handpiece to this one. I'm going to start with an electroplated disc. This is a 120 grit. I attach it with a Velcro. Flip the switch on. And away we go. Now let's let it dry. And take a look. Okay, I see some serious marks yet here. Let's see. Yeah, those there. They're gonna have to come out with this first sand. And there's some more right up here. So we're gonna do some more. Now I think that looks pretty good. So I'll take the 120 grit off. And put on the 200. Okay, now I'll take the 200 grit off and put the 400 grit on. This is still an electroplated disc. Okay, now I'm going to start working on the inside of the bowl. A little different handpiece. These are still electroplated, but sometimes on the inside curves, the edge of the electroplating leaves kind of scratches, deeper nicks. So we'll start with the coarse one, and if that's too bad, then I'm going to switch over to a coarse resin wheel, and I won't have that problem. But the resin wheels aren't quite as aggressive. Get a little water. And away we go.
Dude, that's awesome. I have a question. Like, so that lathe thing, so I know you're using the Fordham tool, and but the whole lathe thing, what do you make that? Did you fabricate that? It looks like it has variable speed.
I basically set up a bracket and got an old poly lap arbor and attached it, and then a pulley on the end with the motor. It's a DC motor with a variable speed, because too fast when you're grinding leaves a lot of chatter on the stone. So they're usually grinding and sanding, that goes quite slow. And a lot of this stuff I made because nobody makes it for me to buy. So I've run into a problem and I just have to think, how am I going to solve it and come up with some ideas? And there we go.
Yeah, no, that's great. Super cool. And the grits, I know in that grinding, you said that was like a 40 grit. Was that the same 40 grit when you were doing the inside?
Yes.
Okay.
So... yeah, I think it's a little too coarse for an agate because it leaves some chatter. 80 grit, I think, would have been a better bet. But yeah. I have a bunch of them, so I'm going to use them up.
Absolutely. We're going to get some questions, but Joanna, why don't you run the next video?
Hey, that worked. Oh, wait a minute. No. It's just... paper towel. That worked really well. Now I think I'm going to go to a 100 grit resin sanding disc. Okay, here's a resin bond diamond disc. Should give me 100 grit. Should give me a little smoother finish than what's on there. Give it a whirl. Okay, now we'll set it up to sand the inside 220 grit. Looks nice for 400. 600 or 800 is next. Okay, 600 grit is next. There, I think that looks pretty nice. Got a lot of nice pattern to it. I think the next step will be the final sand, and that'll be 1200 grit. So I'll get it set up for that. Okay, 1200 grit, final sand. Yeah, I think that looks pretty nice. Now we'll set things up so we can do the final polish.
Roll to the next one. Just go right into the polish.
Okay, so now we'll start to polish the inside of the bowl. Got a felt cylinder here with cerium oxide as a polishing agent. Get things a little bit wet. Add a little bit. And here we go. Now I'm going to set up the other machine to work on the outside. Here I have a felt wheel, again cerium oxide. We'll work on polishing the outside. Yeah, I think that looks really nice, but I'm not done yet. Okay, now I have to take it off the dop stick. This was 5-minute epoxy that I used. And if I get it hot enough, being careful not to heat the stone too much, I can get that off. So with the alcohol lamp, I'm just going to heat up the dop stick. Now the next step I'm going to do is fine grind the bottom and polish that. So here I have the flat lap again. I'm going to clean it off. I'm going to go over to the sanding machine and just slightly round off that edge.
Now we'll go and polish the very bottom. Okay, here we have another felt wheel, this time just a horizontal disc. Add some more cerium oxide. Looking good. One more step I like to do. Now, after all that work I've put into it, you can bet I'm going to sign it. Just a diamond tip point.
You've done that a time or two.
There we go. All finished.
That is so cool, Don. Like, that's ridiculous. Did you guys like this? Like, what you just saw from, like, a rock full thing. One of the things JP was asking. Yeah, you give him some love in the chat. Like, this is really, really, you're seeing, like, huge skill and attention to detail and innovation. Like, you're innovating tooling to achieve what you're trying to achieve.
Right.
I love that.
Yeah, that's awesome.
It kind of reminds me of you, John, when you're doing all this sphere stuff. Same challenge. It's like, how do I do this? And you, yeah. That's
tools really don't cool exist. Stuff. You just got to make them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So how long did it take? Like, you think start, finish, like, obviously you sped things up. What would be the cycle time for making that piece?
A real simple one, probably around 5 or 6 hours like that.
Okay.
Start to finish. Yeah.
So not bad. Not bad at all. I know that Rich is asking, it says Christine, but isn't that you, Rich, that's on there? I think, because I think Rich was on, he did the sculpture one. And I think he was asking a whole bunch of, yeah. Oh, no, it's, oh, okay. How's Christine? Hi, Christine. Rich had done some really cool sculpture pieces as well and earlier. And we're going to be doing some things with him on tumbling. So we got a bunch of questions here. So can you roll a little bit longer here? Because we've got a whole stack of questions, maybe 10.
Yeah, that's right. I've got the whole night.
Okay. So Michelle, the Intarsia Machine team, just get Michelle's contact information, Lizelle, because it is coming out. I think you're doing a first batch, and I think we're like sold through 4 or 6 of those first 10 that you're making, 10 or 20. I don't know how you're doing the first one. We always do a smaller run before we do a big run. 18-inch drop saw, Doug was saying, hey, from YouTube, I would love to get a bigger drop saw, 18-inch drop saw. I think we won't be doing a mechanical one, but I believe there is a drop saw coming out, right there, John?
Yeah.
But it is not going to be mechanical, Doug. It's going to be insanely badass. I was talking to Don a little bit about. So basically, it's going to be, you want to talk just briefly, but not big, long thing, but on that drop saw?
Oh, well, you tell the engineer not to talk long about what he's designing. That's horrible.
All right, just do it quick.
Okay, the 18-inch drop saw I'm working on is actually an auto drop. So basically, I'm using a microprocessor control, and I'm going to be able to tell it to how thick a slab to cut, how many slabs to cut the whole rock. And you can just basically put a rock in it and dice the whole thing if you want to.
faster than a regular drop saw, faster than what you saw, because you're doing a couple dimensions.
Don't tell all the secrets yet.
I won't.
There's still a lot of work to do on it, and I've got like 10 other products that I'm working on ahead of it. But it's 80% designed.
And Christine, a question on, is there a pump kit you can buy for the 14-inch drop saw? The drop saw comes with a tube for the pump, and all you need is the pump. And Lizelle or any of the team can get you hooked up on that. So it's, and if you need just that tube, we got the tube as well. It's a separate part number. I don't know what the part number is, but Lizelle and the team knows what that part. So that is available. Bart had a question. Hey, Bart Nelson, who did the dichro glass stuff, friggin' genius. Where do you get those diamond bits?
I had those specially made from a company in China, going on Alibaba and seeing different companies, and just sent them some drawings and asked them, you know, what the minimum order quantity is on these and how much. Mm-hmm. And that's what they came up with for me. I do have different sizes too.
Yeah. Okay, cool. I mean, this is also stuff that we can collaborate on as well, because we're moving a lot into those kind of pieces. Steve says, will HP making a rock lathe? Are we gonna do a rock lathe? That's for you, Mr. Design.
I've really been thinking a lot about that kind of thing, because I get multiple people asking about things like that. And it's one of those kind of things where I take ideas and I just brew on it for a while.
Well, the thing that Heidi sent me, that's a rock lathe here too.
I'll buy it. If you make one, I'll buy it.
Well, if I make one, what I really want to do is I want to make it so you can throw in a DXF file, so you could come straight out of CAD and do any kind of a profile, and you don't need templates, because then it becomes really powerful. So that's really more along the lines that I'm thinking, because there's people that want to do tall vases, and you can do a lot of stuff if you have a versatile machine. And I think that's really the key, to make an interesting piece of equipment that then frees up the imagination to do any kind of crazy shape.
Right. Because you could just CAD the shape and then output in that. And then that's actually doing your profiling, because that's an axis. You're basically driving that axis.
Yeah.
Yeah. John's doing another crazy 45-inch friggin' crazy sauce too. It's like there's some ridiculous stuff happening at the factory outside of just what you're saying. JP says, do you ever use thermoplastics to hold the stones in place at that size? I think this was in terms of the epoxy, that step where you're epoxying it on.
I've never tried it. I've just always used the epoxy. Okay. I mean, it's always worked. I haven't had one fall off on me, so.
Yeah, that's good.
The only one that fell off is I didn't give it enough time to set up. So definitely.
That's why you're like 12 hours.
At least 12 hours.
Yeah. David was asking, how many RPM is on that lathe? That's variable speed, that lathe, the one that's holding it.
I would say it's going to
200 is what
maybe
I
maybe 100 RPM, maybe a little more.
Yeah.
And to dry it off, I turn it all the way up and spin dry it. And that way I can, you know, inspect it and see if I'm done and can move on to the next step or not.
Yeah.
The grinding wheels, I'm going to guess around maybe 1,000 RPM for the grinding wheels.
Yeah. Okay. Yep. Christine was asking, why don't you use a dome bit for the inside instead of using that fit bit? So you were grinding there. That shape, it looked like it was kind of like the shape of that top of that tool was like that. Was that just because of the design and MOQ quantities that you had to order?
No, the dome bit would work, except if you want to do some intricate designs where you're actually cutting into an inside curve, rather than just the outside that I did on that ball, you're not going to be able to do it with a ball-shaped bit. You're going to have to get in there. And a lot of the dimensions is all by feel. So I'm actually, you know, get my finger in there and my thumb on the outside and kind of check to see if I'm following that pattern. Yeah. That was just a simple curved on the outside, but I've done fancier ones.
Oh, I've seen some of your stuff. It's really, really sweet stuff. JP, I think we answered that question about 5 hours. JP was asking how long did it take? About 5 hours. Dan, question for Bruce and everyone here. Have you ever heard of a stone called sardonyx? I think I've heard of it. And you're talking about a vase in the chat as well, Dan, that you're working on a piece.
Sardonyx is basically your agate from Brazil that has been heated and or dyed to a darker brown color. Yeah. Carnelian is the same stuff, but it's an orangey red color.
Yeah. Sardonyx, typically what they did is they took the whitish Brazilian or Uruguay nodules and they soaked them in a sugar solution. And then they put it in like a boiling sulfuric acid and it carbonizes the sugar where it's penetrated the rock that gives you the alternating black-white banding. Mm-hmm. That is the most typical material called sardonyx. And of course, you see that in a lot of really old carving in arts and museums, is that was a really common way of enhancing an agate, and you know, like a lot of the cameos were done with that material.
Yeah, because agate, believe it or not, is slightly porous and it will take dyes or put your sugar solution, sugar and honey, and let it soak for a while. And then yes, burn it in acid that carbonizes the sugar and that gives it its black color.
Yeah, yeah.
No, that's how I learned it was done.
Yeah.
I tried it once. I don't like playing with acid. It did work. Half of them turned nice black. I'm not going to do it again. You can buy cheap.
We were in Haifeng. What in Haifeng, China?
They do a lot of that here in China.
Yeah. And of course, the people there know they look like they've been around acid too long. In that back room, no ventilation. Let's just go breathe some acid. Ron had a question. Can one be made out of segmented stones the same way I do my wood lathe work?
Yes. I don't think I've done one, but some of the students here have done it that way.
Yeah.
We've glued three slices together and made a bowl that way. And I can think of all sorts of other ways to do it, but you could do it, I'm sure, like you would a wooden ball, all different kinds of patterns.
Yep. And Theodore's iPhone there, president of the Dallas Rock and Gem Society. Absolutely. We'll connect with you, and any of the club members are certainly welcome. We have people register so people don't Zoom bomb. We got Zoom bombed with some 12-year-old kids. So now we have to do this whole registration thing so we don't actually have people try to hijack the chat, which was kind of amusing for those of you that were here. We're like, yes, some 12-year-old people on there. All right, one last question. Ron was asking, I wonder if a vertical lathe could be made and then the overall footprint be minimal.
For certain kind of pieces that might be good, but it does come with some complications.
Yeah.
You could mount it onto a drill press, the stone, and have it turn that way?
Typically, verticals, you're supporting it from the bottom.
From the bottom.
There's not any reason you couldn't kind of flip it over, but it does complicate the structure that you're supporting.
Yeah. Hey, pull up Dan Wiggins here. Dan's doing some cool stuff. When are you going? Pull up Dan up into the chat.
Let me answer JP's question. Can you ever buy a stone from China that has not been treated or violated in any way? it's actually a good question. The stone cutting has radically changed in China in the last 10 years. And there's been two drivers for that. The biggest driver is the cost of labor has increased significantly. So most of the lower end materials are no longer cut here because the material, when you import it, there's high tariffs on it. And then
75 cents per kg import tariffs, yeah, typically. Just, that was like 5 years ago.
It's gotten expensive. So having said that, most of what's getting cut here now is higher end materials. Now there's certainly dealers that still play games and fake stuff. But a lot of it has to do with, do you know who you're working with and are they trustworthy? There's good ones, there's bad ones.
So one of the things you'll still see in Tucson is you'll see the piles of the cheap Chinese stuff, because in the day, you know, the prices were real low there, but most of that is old stock that was produced 5-10 years ago that they're just slowly blowing out. All the low-end cutting has gone to Jaipur, India, a lot of that, Indonesia, because the safety regulations are also much low. China has gotten very strict safety regulations. And that's really a change that we've seen in the, you know, 10 years that we've been there, is it's tight. And labor, for example, labor in southern China is about three times the labor rate in, say, Mexico. It's expensive. Yeah. And the factory space in China is more expensive than what we pay per square feet here in Western Boston.
Yeah,
it's not low cost. Supply chain is really
you don't bring it manufacturing into China for cheap factory space and cheap labor, because neither one of them exist anymore.
Right.
You come here because the supply chain is here.
Yeah,
that's it.
Everything you need to build shit really easily is right there. All right. Anybody work with Hubei turquoise, or where do I get the quality stuff? I don't know. I mean,
good luck. Again, with the turquoise, there are entire factories devoted to creating fake turquoise here.
Right.
Entire factories. I've been in them. Devoted to creating fake stuff. They're using material that's like howlite, and their dyeing process is extremely good. In general, particularly if you're paying very much, I would not be attempting to buy turquoise from China. It's just the likelihood that you're going to get something that's fake is too great.
Right.
Again,
damn.
It's about relationships, and do you really know the person?
Yeah. I want to pull up Dan here. Mr.
Dan's up.
Yeah, but I'm pulling him up so he's on the chat there. Dude, how you doing?
I'm okay, bud. You're right about Jaipur and the carving, stuff like that, because when I go there, I'm amazed every time I go. The thing about the lathe, I have a dedicated drill press that I use for making handles and other types of stone objects that got to be turned. Works really good. Don's right, though. It would be very difficult to do a cup like that because you'd be working off the bottom. Mm-hmm. Tonight, I'm starting up manatees and manta rays. Now, I think you've seen, Sherman, my manta ray sculptures.
Oh, yeah. You've done some cool shit.
Yeah, but I've got an art show coming up a week from today. So mm-hmm. I'm trying to finish off with some of that. But going back to that sardonyx, the vase that I saw was from the Greek or Roman empires. So it was very, very old. And it was absolutely beautiful. It was almost a black with beautiful shades of brown going through it. And it was cut so fine that the light was passing through it. I recently acquired pink Iranian onyx, which is like impossible to find.
Now, how did you get that? That's like forbidden. You cannot supposed to buy anything from Iran, dude. You should not put that on the webinar.
It's okay, because I went, there's a covering show, which is dedicated to tile and stone, every other year to Orlando. If any of you people can make that, it is amazing.
Yeah.
It's all dedicated to tile and stone, but they have all the machinery, the tools, the displays. Well, there was a group there from India at a company about an hour's drive out of Jaipur, which I'll be going to see. But when I walked up to their booth, I saw they had this beautiful pink Iranian on it. And wow. I introduced myself in Hindi. So a white guy in America speaking Hindi is kind of a shock to these people.
Yeah, you make a connection.
Right.
When do you go to India? Because you're going over there, what, next month or a couple months from now?
I'm looking at the end of October or the beginning of November.
So I got a question for you. When you go to India, take pictures, because I mean, I think a lot of people be interested to see what you see, you know, especially you're up in Jaipur. Like, you should shoot some video, because that's like, that is where the cutting is going. There's like, we look at all these big moves. I mean, I think Mexico's a really big opportunity. You know, there's a lot coming back here, but you know, I'm curious on what you see over there. You were not in Jaipur. You were in Bangalore, right, John? Or where'd you?
Yeah, I was way down south. Way down south. Bangalore, Pune, Mysore.
You were in Palakkad.
What's that?
You were in the southern part, or in Kerala state?
Yeah, way down south.
That's a beautiful area.
Yeah.
I would love to have a house there.
Yeah. Now that would be very, very cool. Well, hey, let's wrap. So, hey, thanks. Record that stuff, by the way. We'll see if we can do a webinar together. It'd be kind of fun. So put photo, let's put up, again, put up Dawn's, the information for Dawn. There's the Instagram. Definitely follow him. He's doing some super cool stuff, as you can see. And maybe we can get you on another webinar. I mean, I think.
Yeah,
I think,
for everyone on here, if you really appreciate what Don's done, follow him on what he's doing, help him promote, because he's contributing a lot to the education and in the lapidary arts. And if we want to keep advancing the lapidary arts, then we have to support the people who are doing great work.
Absolutely. And then certainly we ask you to, you know, on the YouTube channel, our YouTube channel, please, if you've not subscribe to the YouTube channel. That gets more people visible to it. They know what's happening. They can learn. And then if you like this, please give us a 5-star review on the Google reviews. Give us a 5-star review, because that helps. It actually helps people know more about this stuff. Because our whole mission, as I've said on previous webinars, our mission is to be able to educate, inspire, and engage people in the lapidary arts, whether they're a craftsperson, whether they're an artist, whether they're just somebody who appreciates and wants to buy beautiful stone products. Our mission is really to make the lapidary arts and associate arts, glass, lapidary, wood, like the connections happening. So there's a much greater awareness and appreciation of this kind of art form, because it is truly amazing. We're passionate about it. And that's why we do these webinars every week, is to really help not only you that are here live, but there's lots of people that find these webinars on the web and they watch them, and it exposes them to what's possible for themselves. Because every little kid loves rocks, and we want to be able to have people have the ability to participate in a lapidary like Don's done in his whole career. For people maybe have another job, they can come back to this and really find the thing that they love. So definitely give us a review. Give us a 5-star review. And then, you know, certainly you have a Google business page, Don. Do you know?
No, I don't.
We need to help you get a Google business page. So you can give him a 5-star review.
A lot of help on the internet technology.
Well, we're going to do webinars. So we have webinars coming that are about marketing. A lot of all of you have said, please do more marketing stuff. So we're going to be doing that. You know, obviously we want to support our friends and really help all of you succeed in the arts. So we love you being here, and certainly stay tuned for next week. I will not be on the, well, I don't know, maybe I'm in the call, but I'm in Europe next week. We're visiting customers over there, but John will certainly be here, and we'll see you the following week. Anything else you want to say to wrap up, John?
No, that's great. Thanks so much, Don.
You are most welcome. And thank you, and the whole team there put on an excellent production, and thanks for the recognition. I appreciate it.
Yeah, you're doing amazing stuff, and I want to do more stuff with you, dude.
Okay. Yeah, we got to talk about faceting, I think.
Yes. All right. That'd be great.
All right. All right, you guys. Thank y'all. Have a good evening.
Thanks, everybody.